statement. When you think about the record of healing that Jesus effected, after all, he healed paralysis, blindness, deformity, deafness, insanity. He raised the dead. He even challenged the laws of gravity by walking on water. Well, are any of those healings taking place today? Well, if you were to look in the last 100 pages of this book, Science and Health, you'd find a chapter on fruitage. And in that chapter, you would find healings of cancer, heart disease, tuberculosis, rheumatism, rupture, tumors, and any number of sinful acts of behavior. Well, some might say, yeah, but John, that's over 100 years old when that book was written. Yeah, but it was only through reading the book that the person had the healing. There was no other help. And so that book that was then is that book that is now, that each of us has access to. It's a living word that you're dealing with here. It's a revelation of God's presence and power. However, if we were to go to current times, we would be exploring the publications that are available today. And one of them is a Christian Science Journal. It's a monthly magazine that's published by the Christian Science Publishing Society. And in every one of these journals, which is monthly, as I say, there are always verified accounts of healing. And if you were to go over, let's say, the last 2 years of reading just the healings that are accounted for in each of these journals, you would find healings of vaginal tumor, heart disease, several cases of cancer that were healed, lumps in the breast, a facial tumor, infertility, pneumonia, broken bones, persistent hemorrhaging, warts, allergies, and so on. So Christian healing is taking place today. It's not going to necessarily be on the front page of the local paper, but it is taking place. And I'd encourage any of you who aren't familiar with Christian Science to make it your business to get yourself a copy of this book. There are copies outside that are requesting, church is requesting donations of $5 for the book. But it will be the best spent $5 you've ever used. Now, when our family was young, we used to visit my folks who had a home on the Jersey Shore. They were in Cape May. It was all the way down to the tip. Some of you may be familiar with that area. There's a lot of Victorian homes there right on the beach. It's just gorgeous. And my folks had a home directly across from the water, so we tried to get there as frequently as we could. When we arrived on one occasion, our two little boys came running in the house in pain and terror. In their childlike abandon, they had uncovered a wasp nest, and both boys had been severely stung. The little boy 3 times, the older boy 9 times. And while I picked up the older boy and ushered him into a front bedroom, my wife and my mother took care of our younger son, brought him comfort. Immediately, I assured my son that God loved him and that no harm would come to him. And I noticed that my father, who was a good student of Christian Science, had parked himself in the corner of the room and was already in deep prayer, supporting my efforts to quiet our boy's hysteria. Perhaps it's the same with you folks, but when an incident that seems beyond my immediate control occurs, I reach beyond myself for an idea that will bring comfort and assurance to the moment from a source of wisdom and power greater than me. Some refer to that as prayer to God. Well, in this instance, as I was praying, an idea did come to me, and it was from this book, Science and Health. Now, I didn't remember the entire paragraph I'm going to share with you, but I remembered enough of it that it calmed my thought sufficiently to the point that my tonal quality softened and appeared to be assuring. And it quieted our boys down. This is what I recalled. Understanding the control which love is capitalized here, and that's a synonym as used for God in Christian Science when it is capitalized. Understanding the control which love held over all, Daniel felt safe in the lion's den, and Paul proved the viper to be harmless. All of God's creatures, moving in the harmony of science, are harmless, useful, indestructible. I wonder, would that include the wasps? A realization of this grand verity was a source of strength to the ancient worthies. It supports Christian healing and enables its possessor to emulate the example of Jesus. All of God's creatures working in the harmony of science are harmless, useful, indestructible. Well, upon first reading, that statement appeared to be contradictory because of my children's pain and the material evidence of the welts and swelling on their bodies. But further consideration revealed a vital fact, and that was this, that the author, Mary Baker Eddy, was writing from a spiritual standpoint, and she was envisioning a spiritual creation where harmony is eternally perfect. She writes, "When we realize that life is spirit, never in nor of matter, this understanding will expand into self-completeness, finding all in God, good, and needing no other consciousness." So when spiritual consciousness prevails as the only true consciousness, then human perception, with its limitations, its discords, doubts, and fears, fades entirely from thought. That's Christian Science. Well, Johnny fell asleep. And during the period of time he was asleep, the adults in the house all sort of went into their own mental closets and found themselves deep in prayer, praying for a spiritual solution to the problem the boys were faced with. And about an hour later, Johnny awakened and bounded from the bed as if nothing had ever happened. The welts and swelling were entirely gone. He engaged in the rest of the day. And his younger brother, who'd been playing quietly in the other room, was also free of any evidence of ever having been stung. What had happened? Was it because this type of a wasp, the sting didn't last? Was it that they weren't allergic to wasp stings and so on and so forth? No. It was the result of Christian Science prayer. Now, I was thinking that a lot of people don't know what takes place in a Christian Science treatment. It all seems sort of mystifying to them, that somebody closes their eyes and is silent and the physical evidence changes. And I thought, well, I need to give an illustration of how we arrived at the healing. And so I asked members of the church if they would please bring a 5-gallon bucket and a hula hoop. That's why you see this up here on the stage. Now, for the sake of conversation, let's take this bucket and let's fill it all the way to the top with water, and then let's refer to it as the human experience. Do you have that so far? My, what an anemic response. Do you have it so far?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's take this hula hoop, which is a circle and therefore a symbol of eternal life, and let's refer to this as spiritual man and spiritual woman. That which is made in the image and likeness of God, eternal life, that which has no beginning and no ending. And now, for the sake of conversation, I'll refer to it just as spiritual man, but you'll know that I'm using the term generically, which is all inclusive. Now, let's take spiritual man, and let's put spiritual man into the human experience. Well, by golly, spiritual man doesn't fit the human experience. But it does look like a portion of spiritual man has dipped in, so where the hula hoop has entered into the bucket, let's call that birth. And where it's underneath the surface of the water, let's refer to that as the different states and stages of the human experience. And where it exits, let's call that death. Do you have that so far?
Yes.
Okay. Question. Is the hula hoop ever severed? Is it ever interrupted? It is what it is, isn't it? Now, the hula hoop is plastic. It's a non-porous element. You could throw this into your swimming pool, and it would never really get wet. Oh, it might take on the appearance of being wet, but a quick wipe would show you that it really never is. And so it is with spiritual man and the human experience. So it is with the Christ and the human identity of Jesus. Each one of us is already the image and likeness of God. This is our primary identity. And this is what takes place in a Christian Science treatment. When the evidence appears as the reality of the individual, the Christian Science healer stops and pauses and says, oh, no, wait, hold on. There's a higher priority here. You already have your first identity, and your first identity is permanent and perfect. This is how the argument of healing takes place. And when that is established clearly enough, the physical evidence conforms to what God is knowing about His own creation. That God, man, and the universe remain perfect eternally in the Father's love. Well, this is sort of what we did. This was the way that we spiritually reasoned for our children. And by today's standards, if this incident were to occur, it wouldn't be unusual for parents concerned with their children's well-being to pick up the phone and call a local doctor, perhaps a pharmacist, or maybe even the emergency room of a hospital, seeking advice on medical care. But the two tools most used by Christian Scientists for healing are these two. Why the Bible? Well, the Bible is filled with wise counsel, from the Ten Commandments to the Sermon on the Mount to the 91st Psalm to the Lord's Prayer to over 80 accounts of spiritual healing in the New Testament. Why wouldn't a person want to turn to God to seek comfort, assurance, and healing? And Science and Health, because it's the complete statement of Christian Science. It spiritually interprets Scripture. It defines you and me, man and woman, as made in the image of God, spirit, therefore spiritual. And it does something else. It teaches one how to pray effectively. Now, as I said before, the first chapter is on the subject of prayer. This is the book, this is the chapter I sent Ben to, remember? And he was on page 10 when he had a character transformation and the healing finalized. I'm going to take you to the very first sentence, to the very first paragraph on the very first page. I'm going to share this with you, and then I'm going to show you how the practical application of this understanding can bring wonderful results. It reads, "The prayer that reforms the sinner and heals the sick is an absolute faith that all things are possible to God, a spiritual understanding of Him, an unselfed love." Actually, that prayer is three rules. One, an absolute faith that all things are possible to God. Courage and a confident trust in God's love and healing power. Two, a